Hallelujah. A lot of hard work. So thank y'all for coming out and helping everybody coming together. That's what it means to be community, to be family, and that's why we're out here today. And I know that most of the people here already woke, but some of the stuff that we're going to go through today, also we're going to do an assembly, but that's all about, you know, commitment and stuff, so we want to gauge and see how many people were willing to do so, and that's why we're here. So thank you for all coming, and I'm sure there'll be more people coming. We want to do some evangelism in the local neighborhood. Hallelujah. So we give this glory, honor, and praise for being part of that. We're no longer the tail, we're becoming the head. And we're going to give him glory, honor, and praise not only through our lips, but also through our lives. Hallelujah. Yeah. So, King Prem Melaket Koanim, a lot of people can't say it, so let's practice, right? Let's practice, ma'am. Like, yes, ma'am. Ma'am. Let. Ket. Let's say it together. Ma'am, the ket. Oh, that's easy, right? I struggled with it myself in the first couple of months. And I'm the one that got, you know, open my eyes to. So, remember that, you know. So, and then you got Cohen, like, you know, people don't say my first name, right? Cohen, they say Cohen, right? So, Cohen, that means priest. Cohen means priest. So, Kohanim means multiple priests. Us. Right, so it's like El means God, Elohim, right? That's what makes it plural. That's the im. That's what makes it plural. So we got to learn about our culture. I'm learning too. We got to learn, you know, about our language. It's all very important because as we look through archaeology and look through facts and look through even in the language, as we talked about last week, the people in Africa, they spoke Paleo-Hebrew, some of them. And this is in the late 1800s. So, you know, this is our language. Hallelujah. So, the mission is to preserve, support, promote the culture, history, and heritage of the African Ivri. Do you know what Ivri means? What's Ivri mean?
Hebrew.
That's the original word of Hebrew, and Hebrew is Ivri. So, there's some Ivri people up in West Africa that was enslaved. People scattered worldwide through the diaspora. Objectives to raise awareness and support to assist those who descend from the ancient African Ivri groups scattered throughout the globe and with their desires to learn more about their history. Y'all have a desire to learn about the history?
Yes.
Hallelujah. The organization efforts will be to connect or reconnect, right, with others of this heritage scattered through the world through education, research, networking, media, and charitable efforts. So that's what we're doing now with the Wells and, you know, solar power over there in Africa, Zimbabwe. So thank you for your help and your contributions. It's very important that we do that, especially for the Levites. That's what the word tells us to do. So we want to be obedient fully to the word and not just be the things that we want to partake in, but the thing he wants us to partake in as well. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right, so Exodus, hey. 19:5-6. Now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people. Now, is it wrong to say that we're above all people? When scripture says, right? Yeah. Right now we're not. Right? We're all at the bottom. Right? But his scripture says, if you do right, you will be above all people. For all the earth is mine. So he said he is his. So he's the one who established who he's going to give it to and who he's not. He's a good officer, a good father. And ye shall be unto me a what?
A kingdom of priests.
What's that mean? Mamlekat Koanim. There we go. And that's what it means. The Mamlekat Koanim and the holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. And that's who we are. And then, you know, people say, oh, that's, you know, Old Testament done away with. So let's look at it in the New Testament. I think it's a little tighter in the New Testament.
Yeah.
So the Brit Hoxha. So it says 1 Peter 2, 2 chapters 9-10. But you are a chosen
generation.
And NASB even says race. I didn't even put the capitals in anything. It was straight out NASB. It put the capitals. Chosen race. So a race that's hated and talked about and down all the time. It says you're the chosen race. Mm-hmm. Right? A royal
priesthood.
That goes at Koanim, right? A holy nation, a people for Yah's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellency. So we have an excellent calling in our life and what we need to do upon this earth of him who has called you out of darkness into the marvelous light. Anybody ready to get out of darkness?
Yes.
Hallelujah. They used to say Congo was the heart of darkness. So we came out of the darkness, and now it's like, oh, we're going to something today, right? Using scripture. All right. So for once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. You have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. It's good to be entering into that time of mercy, because we can see how the slave trade and even all the other times in our life we didn't get that mercy. But now he says mercy is coming. So we need to get in line with him. Hallelujah. So that's what Amalekite Kohanim is all about. Go to the next slide. So we got to talk about our customs. So I know even with us, we got all even different customs as y'all bring us all together. But here we got to make sure we at least know each other that each other's talking about, as well as, you know, new people come in, be able to explain it. So this is a time that we're trying to preserve our customs. And how do we preserve our customs the best way? Practicing, living them. All these customs that lived throughout Africa, all these generations, is because the oral customs that they kept from the Torah. Because they got the Torah taken and burned and all that stuff as they migrated over to different parts of Africa, but they still circumcised on the eighth day. Right? Their children. They rename their children on the eighth day. They do all those things, the door knocking ceremony when they get married. And Yah said, if he knocks on the heart of your door and you open, he will enter in. That's part of the African culture. They knock on the door for the bride, for the person they want to marry. They get the whole city, and they all walk, all their friends, they come to the bride's house with the person they want to marry, they knock on that door. I'm glad to say if you open that door, because it would be very embarrassing to be for all them people and I had that door open, right? So, you know, we don't want to embarrass him. He knocks on the heart of your door, right? So he said, if you're ashamed of me before men, I'd be ashamed before you, before Father. Hallelujah. So we got to understand some of these customs. So let's go to the next. So we got somebody coming with the shofars. So we got some shofar blowers in here. So we start with the shofar. So we get ready to blow. We got two of them here. And then if you have a shofar, bring it on out. Because we want to make sure we're part of what we're trying to do as part of our customs. And it's very important to understand because he said, make yourself, you got to get some civil trumpets. You know, I just learned this myself. I heard it before, but just, you know, starting to serve someone outside of the house, it makes it a little different, right? It says, make yourself two trumpets of silver, of hammered work. You shall make them, and you shall use them for summoning congregation for having the camp set out. When both are blown, all the congregation shall gather themselves to you at the doorway of the tent of meeting. So when you blow the trumpet, it's the time to assemble. That's very important. Very important scripture, because a lot of stuff that Yah puts in place, he's trying to foreshadow something that's yet to come. All right? So it says, with trumpets and sounds of the horn, shout before the king, shout joyfully before the king, Yahuwah. So he's saying that use these sounds to shout and praise him, right? So it's not something crazy, he's telling us to do it. All right? Psalms 53, praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with harp and lyre. Praise him with timbre. Anybody got a cymbal? Timbering? Can I get some timbering shake? Come on. All right. We got some more timberings in here. All right. And dancing. So we're trying to get a little young ladies to start getting some dance. We got some plans. Praise him with string instruments and pipes. We got some of the boys that are coming with us some music here, hopefully next week as well. So we, you know, y'all's building us up. He's putting those things in place. So as we do this, where do you fit in? Right? Because it's not just me. It's not just the people that you see working today. It's all of us. So where did God has blessed you with the gifts and talents to use to glorify his name and edify his people? We got to do those things. Hallelujah. Isaiah 8:33. All you inhabitants of the world and dwellers on the earth, as soon as the standard is raised on earth, you will see it. And as soon as the trumpet is blown, you will hear it. What is he talking about? This is prophecy now. We got away from the things about us coming together just as a group. Now he's talking about something that's going on in the future, right? So, you might have heard this before, Isaiah 27:13. It will come about also in that day. What does that mean? Future, right? Yeah. That a great trumpet will be blown. And those who are perishing in the land of Assyria, what? Somebody who are perishing in the land of Assyria? What's that mean? Uh-oh. Got a little quiet on them. And who was scattered in the land of Egypt will come and worship Yahuwah in the holy mountain at Jerusalem. So we know these are Israelites. There's something going on with the Israelites in Assyria. There's something in Egypt. And we talked a little bit about Isaiah 11, talking about the highway to Assyria that will come in the last days. So from Egypt and even in Assyria, other scripture talks about that. And if we know about the great trumpet in that day that would gather the people in Isaiah 27:13, we go to the Brit Hadashah, New Testament, in Matthew 24:31, it says, and he will send forth his angels with a what? A great trumpet. Ain't nothing in Isaiah 27:13 about a great trumpet. Why would it keep it in capital? When you read the NASB, what I tell y'all about NASB when it's capitalized?
It's
mentioned in the Tanakh, in the Old Testament, right? So why everybody like this is a mystery when this is a scripture that tells you exactly what's going to happen during that time? So this is why it's so important for us to actually take forth our customs so we will understand prophecy as well. So it says, and they will gather together his elect. Who's his elect? The kingdom of priests. Man, we can't go in, right? From the four winds, scattered throughout the world, from one end of the sky to the other. Hallelujah. Like I said, I didn't capitalize none of this, so this is what NASB is telling you. So let us get the trumpets together, let us just shout them, you know, go ahead and blow them to God's glory, so we can actually begin. So I don't have to go through this all next time, right? Let's go ahead and blow it unto the glory of God. Help me keep it on. Hallelujah. All right. RBJ's here. I'm not about titles either, but if you want to prefer a title, there's some titles there that you can call me, or you can just call me an English pastor or whatever else. Yes.
So, Brother Coleman, what do we call Miss D? I just call her sister.
Oh, cool.
We call each other sister.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. I don't know.
Deidre? Yeah, she said Deidre's fine. And she is fine to me. Yeah.
Angel?
Angel. Oh, she said Angel. Now, that's
so
something
like that. She's talking about her nickname.
She said Angel. I like Angel. That's what I'm the word for Angel in Hebrew.
Don't worry about it. It's Angel.
It's Angel.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Sir.
So, you know, this is the words that, you know, I say that would be helpful for us to use. Yes.
So, do we stop? Do you want to get away from being called Mr. Cole? Because that's how I, you know.
Oh, no, I'm still that. If you want to look at that, I'm good with that. I just going to start saying, Jason, I'm good. Jason is fine with me. You know, the reason why I did that is because Jason, for people that don't know, Jason is actually my name. It's my middle name. So, my mom called me Jason. I'm like, I got a Hebrew name. Some people convert and change their Hebrew name, which is great. But I got one already. So that's why I started going by Jay Shear when I was 40. My 40th birthday, so I'm not 40 anymore. I wish I was, but you know, that's when it was. You know, so, you know, but I'm cool. You know, people in the community call me by my nickname. The guy actually who's over this director over the center, grew up with him. So y'all gonna hear some nicknames and, you know, don't use that. But it's all love. It's all good. You know, I prefer Jay here, but, you know, there's other titles and stuff that, you know, is fine with me. I'm still the same. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Next. So, thank you. Zadika. It says, what is the name? So, Yahusha, Yahashua. It's Yahuwah's salvation. You can say Yah. It's sing unto Elohim. Sing praises to the name and start him that rise on upon the heavens by his name, Yah, and rejoice before him. So even if you go to the New King James Version, and you just on your app, just pull up Bible app, go to New King James, just put in the word Yah. See the number of times it comes up. So when people say, why you use that name? I'm like, why don't you read your Bible? It says it in the Bible, you know? We say hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. We say it every week. Most of you know, even the scripture don't even know what it means. Praise y'all. That's what we say. Shine y'all. All right. Let's go to the next. All right. So prayer and scripture. So help Mickey, you mind coming up here and giving us a scripture and some and prayer?
Ungodly are not so, but like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor the sinner in the congregation of the righteous. For the Most High knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Let us pray.
Understand?
Which belongs to you. You said it in your word, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. You said you hear from heaven, you forgive our sins and you heal our lands. Abba, we have need of your healing power, not on our land. We, these vessels which belongs to you. But truly, we want to be that which you have called and created and purposed us to be, the salt of the earth and the light of the world, that you are glorified, that you are honored, that you are praised. For the whole duty of man is to fear the Most High Elohim and to keep his commandment. But this is the whole duty of man, so we pray, Abba, for we want to truly enter into your kingdom. And we just thank you for all that you have done and all you get to do, continue to do in our lives, and watching over us and keeping us and providing for us. And we pray, Abba, that we will not misrepresent you, but that we will honor you with every essence of our being, to love you with all our heart, soul, and mind, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this answer. For his coming forth with your word. We pray that you continue to strengthen him and guide him, Abba, for truly that you are honored and that you are praised, and we pray that you will watch over each individual that's represented here today. Keep them and help them to manifest those gifts that you have placed within them, yes, that you are glorified and that you are praised. We ask this in the name of your only begotten Son, Yahushua HaMashiach, and we say, amen.
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 Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Keep track of time since we do have a time to end. Alright. So, praise and worship. So, we got some praise and worshipers today. So, we're going to come with one selection and then we're going to go into another part of the lesson. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Get them cymbals, tambourines, and trumpets out.
Yehuda on the screen. You all know what Judah means, right?
Praise.
Judah means praise. So we're going to praise the Most High.
It's all the same for everyone.
Say, devil not today.
Devil not today.
All right. So we're going to talk a little bit about our culture and our history. So this is going to be part of our service now. We're going to give you a little tidbit to let you know who we are with confidence. That's the thing I find that a lot of people like, I know the people, but how do you know the people from Africa became or are the Israelites? Hallelujah. So every week we're going to do a little every, which means Hebrew, right? That's why we're trying to use some of our language in the original language. Every means Hebrew. Heritage facts, all right? I like that picture too, Steve. All right, she gets some slides together to help, like, for people who are new to this. So she's helping me get, like, a little class and a little some stuff to kind of, like, a little resource cheat sheet guide for those who are coming in the awakening, so be looking forward to that. All right, next. So, we got the Igbo. Everybody heard of the Igbo? Igbo, Uibu, all of them the same. Anybody heard of them?
Yes.
All right, so this is the Igbo tribe, and this is the king, at least at that time, and this is kind of small, so I might need my help from Angel there. We are the Igbos in Afrion village of Omobri tribe. We are waiting a long time for the arrival of the who? Israelites. This is straight from the king. So Igbo is one of the people that one of the tribes who helped some. I can't see that because it's off the slide, but read that for me. We, the Igbo, have been moved all around the screen. Have been waiting for you. And we have connections with you for ages. So they're waiting to make a connection back with their people. And he's been there waiting for a connection back to their people. All right? It appears in the book of Genesis. As I mentioned, Iri, whose name our village is named after, Aquil Iri, he is among the descendants of Israel. All right. It's just a little bit too light. So is it written in Genesis chapter 46, verse 15 through 16. Give it exactly the chapter, book, and everything. I'll go back to it. 46, 15 through 16. So when you find that, somebody read that for me too. That'd be good. Genesis 46, 15 through 16. Come on in. Here is mentioned there, and he is the son of Gad. All right? And this Gad is the son of Jacob, and so we are connected to Israel. Let's put that in there. know, God is one of the tribes of Israel that came, you know, with them. So they know their connection to the tribe of Gad. And Hebrews also are not just the tribe of Gad. They also have Judah among them. They have different tribes among them. This particular guy who's on the throne, they say that there's actually some Paleo-Hebrew writing somewhere around there. And it actually has the word Gad on it, ancient Hebrew, that they actually have there. And a lot of their different objects. So if you go to Nigeria, this is a good place to find out about your history, right? So we have people there. If you want to come connect with them, they'll tell you, take you on the tour and everything else. All right, next. So, African-American slave trade, you can see the different places that they took us from and where we end up being. So you see the blue there, the Bight of Biafra, that's where the Igbos come from. So where did the blue? Blue. Where do you see mostly the blue? In Virginia. 36% of the slaves, they say, around went to Virginia, 2% went to the Carolinas and Georgia, and 10% of them went to more of the Midwest, right? So if you don't know anything about North Carolina, we got most of our heritage, our people were enslaved, mostly in Virginia and Georgia because we have the Outer Banks and a lot of the ships couldn't go through the Outer Banks. So a lot of our heritage and culture will come from Virginia, South Carolina, Georgia as well. Charleston had the biggest, one of the biggest slaving ports, as well as you're talking about Jamestown and a lot of different places they actually brought the slaves. All right, next. So this is actually talking about more information on the Bight of Biafra. And you can see where it talks about the number of Igbo slaves, or the different kingdoms, the Sayo civilization, that's in Chad. And that's very important because my DNA pops up there. You get a DNA test to tell you, come from that civilization, right? That's kind of in the Cameroon area, Nigeria area now. But it talks about the Bight of Biafra contained a number of ethnic groups, including the Igbo, the Igbolo, the Igala, the Efke, the Ijo, the Ajani, and groups become involved in the slave trip were the Oro. So the Oro were the ones that helped enslave us. So that's what I say. Make sure you understand before you go there, who you're talking to, a tribe, not saying they're going to be against us, but it's good to know, right? Gotta know, you know, there was some slave trading that happened there that sent us to the Europeans as well, right? So a lot of you don't like to talk about that history, but remember, in Europe, is a European just means that you're from France? Is a French person the same as a German?
No.
Is a German the same as somebody from Denmark?
No.
So why are we at like all Africans are the same? It's one of the biggest continents in the world. So is a Cameroonian the same as a Nigerian, the same as a Igbo, the same as a Ashanti? These are all different people groups that we got to identify. Don't let them just put us in the bottle and say you African American, two continents, right? What is America? We talking about South America, North America? What are we talking about? The Caribbean? What are we talking about, right? So you can see how our identity has been stolen, it's been lost even in our names, right? So let's go to the next. We're not going to go through all this, but that's what we're going to talk about some in the genealogy class for some of y'all that signed up. We're going to talk a little bit more about slave trade and where we come from. But there's a museum that has an Igbo farm on it that they did. If you want to go to, I think it's Staten, Virginia. I went there, actually took some pictures. So nearly 40% of the Africans imported to Virginia during the time were bought from a part of West Africa, African coast called the Bight of Biafra. They say 40% of those in Virginia came from there. Many of these captives were Igbo. Many of them were Igbo. All right? So let's go to the next slide. So Thomas Jefferson, he says that the Africans were dirty and nasty. And he slept with that woman and had all these children, right? But so very nasty, he couldn't keep his hands off of that black woman, right? So it talks about here at Monticello slavery, you go there and visit. They said that, you know, a lot of the slaves that he inherited, they really weren't sure they came from, but based on what is known in 18th century slave trades, Virginia ports, the forebears of those enslaved at Monticello were most likely brought from the Western Africa, especially the land of the Igbo. So a lot of those people that Thomas Jefferson had were Igbo slaves. Very important, because we'll go to the next slide. Because I got a sign to go to Farmville, Virginia. I went there to meet my son. We took a picture beside the sign, just like all these black people, right? All the black people, right? That basically came descended from that place, right? And it says, just to the west lies Israel Hill, settled in 1810 to 1811 by approximately 90. Formerly enslaved persons who received freedom in 350 acres from Judith Randolph, listen to this, Judith Randolph, and under the will of her husband, Richard Randolph, cousin of who? This is cousin. So when you have somebody who's granddaddy, you gonna give your children something? You got slaves, what are you gonna give you? More slaves, gonna give your grandchildren slaves, right? You know, they gonna inherit the same slaves that you had. So a lot equals an approximate river boatman. So it basically talks about how, you go back down, that book on the right, you actually get that book. It talks about Israel Hill. It's actually written by a white man from William & Mary College. And he talks about how the slaves were suing people even before slavery was over. They were suing white people, women, because they owned this land. And now you go there, it's just a whole bunch of heaps. Like, who's going to preserve our history, right? That's what Memleket Kohanim, that's what we're trying to preserve some of this stuff. Right? So we can see the same Igbo slaves. Some of them came in this area, Thomas Jefferson. They called themselves Israelites, even here in America. They called themselves that when they were freed. And they actually called it Israel Hill. So go to Israel Hill before some of our places. All right, next. I went there, and a lot of them didn't even know who they were. So they didn't know signs there. I was like, you see the sign? I was like, what sign? I told them, like, oh, let's check that out. But they had a place called Igbo Landing, and that's in Atlanta. It's in Georgia, where the Igbo slaves were coming. They decided to jump off the boat and kill themselves. I think, Beyonce did a little video when she goes into the river, and there's supposed to be something connected to Igbo Landing, but you know, I don't watch a lot of sexual stuff, so I can't tell you exactly what it was about. But Nat Turner, they also think that his father was an Igbo and his mom was a Ashanti. You get some rumors around that. So they said the Igbos were rebellious. You know, they said, I'd rather jump in the river and die than to be enslaved. They said, I'm going to fight you. So a lot of people didn't want Igbos. That's why you see in Virginia that, and you can see why. You know, Nat Turner, waiting up, like, oh, yeah, we don't want a lot of Nat Turners around. Nat Turner changed a lot around slavery, laws, and everything. All right, next. So, in here in North Carolina, we got a place called Taylortown, North Carolina, by Southern Pines, where they played golf in. Taylortown was started by Demas Taylor, who is an Igbo. So we got Igbos here all throughout North Carolina. They don't even know. We go to Taylortown, I'm talking, they're like, oh, I didn't know about all this stuff, right? So I got this right off their website. And I went there, and that's a picture actually until it talks about history. But you can see in my DNA, at least got 22% Nigeria from Anambra. And that's exactly where they said that the Igbo Israelites live as well. All right, so you have the same thing. I'm saying all this because this is your DNA. My DNA is probably a good percentage of your DNA, especially from this area. All right, next. And we got Henry Kissinger, who's a Jew that was part of the Holocaust, that came here, became the Secretary of State during a war called the Biafra War. He says, the Igbos are the wandering Jews of West Africa. This is a White House document. He even talks about them, right? So this is on the White House document. So why we don't know our history? Why we don't know about this, right? Probably don't even know about the Biafra War, right? So why is all this, you know, when it comes to some of our viewpoints, when we see things happening in Africa, we should have a connection because these are our people as well, African American. Which one comes first, African American? African, right? So that should be first. All right, let's go to the next, African Living America. And this is actually where the place I went to go try to find, but they were closed, but actually in North Carolina, in the same place in Southern Pines, you see their address, Southern Pines, they have one of the oldest forms of Black Judaism that's right there within here in North Carolina. It was basically connected to the place in Suffolk, Virginia, and I think they were in the 1800s. So I was trying to scan to see the date, but I don't see the date yet. But you can see it says the oldest Hebrew Israelite congregation in the United States, which is Church of God and Saints of Christ. So they're connected to that group. A lot of people don't even know. So I don't, you know, promote them because of some of their beliefs. They recognize Jesus as Messiah, but he's more of an example from my understanding. All right, some of y'all saw the video I sent out, hopefully, on WhatsApp.
Yes.
All right, so that's part of that. That's that group they're talking about. All right, next. All right, so hopefully that Hebrew heritage fact will help you. You know, as we do this every week, you'll get some more information. I got one of my young brothers back there that's going to come and help us do this. You know, he's stepping up to help do this, so I'm going to help him as well. But this is why it's so important for, and that's how we're going to preserve our history, give it to the next generation. So if they can walk in confidence, then, you know, who's going to stop us? Hallelujah. All right, so let's get some true praise, all right? So we're going to have some people come up. Let me see. I think, I don't know how y'all want to do it, one or two. Feel free to come up and do your song and help us direct us in praise. Oh, yeah, we got a different program today. We're mixing it up on you. Be ready at all times. Right, so, oh, yeah. Yes. Yes. Somebody had a question?
No.
You sure?
No, it's not. So, when you were talking about down in Southern Pines, and I listened to the video yesterday.
Uh-huh.
So, my sister-in-law's best friend is a cable. So, in that area, you know, like Jeff K.
Cornell. Oh, okay. Yeah.
So, but slaves. And the slaves, like you were saying, took over some, not took over, but they moved to that area, right? But somewhere in there, they got hold to, you know, some this color. Mm-hmm. And so that's why all of the capos are this color.
Oh, okay.
So they don't like this color.
Well, that's the thing, is that, you know, a lot of the issues, and that's the colorism that happened before. And then there were some free blacks, too, that people don't know about.
Yes, sir. And I spoke on it because of what you were saying. When you put the two together, and I started thinking about the notes I took down off the video yesterday, and I was like, wait a minute, I can say this right fast to let, I say it out loud to let others, they might know, or they have heard of it, or if they don't, then you can always Google it, because I Googled some stuff yesterday,
yes.
And I saw some stuff, and what I said was serious. Like, I mean, what I heard and what I read, that's some serious stuff.
All right, yeah.
Like, I did not realize.
And stuff. Yes, yeah. There's a lot of different groups of Israelites, so that's why I said be careful what you read. Be careful what you get involved with, because, you know, all Judaism is not what we're moving towards. We want to move to our culture, which was Israelite. There's a reason why Yehusha said, these are the traditions of men, right?
Yes.
That's before any Christianity even came. What traditions he's talking about? He's talking about those Babylonian traditions that actually came. They ended up turning into rabbinical Judaism. So that's why we don't, you know, involve ourselves in those things. We focus us hard enough to do what we're supposed to do. So let's focus on the things that he gave us and give him glory, honor, and praise. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
If anybody could turn to Deuteronomy chapter 6.
Can you take that microphone down?
Yes.
Shabbat, Israel. You are the God that healeth me. You are the God I healer. You sent your word and healed our diseases. You are the God I healer. God is the God that healeth me. God is the God I healer. He sent his word and healed our diseases. God is the God I healer. You are the God that healeth me. You are the God I healer. You sent your word and healed our diseases. You are the God I healer. God is the God, is the God that healeth me. God is the God,
is the God
I healer. He sent his word and healed my disease. God is the God I deserve. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is all I long to do. I give you praise.
Right.
For you are my righteousness. I worship you, O mighty God. There is none like you. There is none like you. There is none like you. I worship you, O mighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is all I long to do. I give you praise. For you are my righteousness. I worship you, O mighty God. There is none like you.
His words are true, and all his ways are judgment. God is faithful, and there is no unrighteousness in him. Just and holy is the Master.
They have sinned, not pleasing him, spotted children, afford a perverse generation.
Do ye thus recompense
his defeat, thus foolish and unwise? Did not he himself, thy father, purchase thee, and make thee and form thee? Just to let you know, I took this out of the Septuagint, so the Lord might not be capitalized. So y'all feeling good, because the Lord is not capitalized, it actually means master, Adonai. Yeah. When it's capitalized, in the King James and other versions, they intentionally took the name Yahuwah out and replaced it with the capitalized word. So you can say Yah or Yahuwah. Say Yahuwah. Maybe Yah. Yah. Everybody good with Yah. All right. Verse 7. Remember the days of old. Consider the years for past ages. Ask thy father, and he shall relate to thee. Thine elders and they shall tell thee.
When the Most High divided the nations, and when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the nations according to the number of the angels of Yah.
That's why we read it out of the Septuagint, because the other version says to the number of the Israelites, the number of something there. So you can see the original version says angels. Verse 9, and his people Jacob became the portion of Yahuwah. Israel was the line of his inheritance.
He maintained him in the wilderness, in the burning thirst, and in dry land. He led him about and instructed him, and kept him as the apple of an eye.
As an eagle would watch over his brood, and yearns over his young, receives them having spread his wings, and takes them upon his back.
Yah alone led him, and there was no strange Yah with him.
He brought them up on the strength of the land. He fed them with the fruits of the fields. They sucked honey out of the rock and oil out of the solid rock.
Blood of cows and milk of sheep, with the fat of lambs and rams, of calves and kids, with fat of kidneys of wheat. And he drank wine, the blood of the grape.
So Jacob ate, and he and was filled. And the beloved one kicked. He grew fat. He became thick and broad. Then he forsook Yah, that made him, and departed from Yah, his Savior.
They provoked me to anger with strange gods, and their abominations did bitterly anger me.
They sacrificed to devils and not to Yah, to gods whom they knew not. New and fresh gods came in, whom their fathers knew not.
Thou hast forsaken Yah, that begot thee, and forgotten Yah, who feeds thee.
And Yahuwah saw, and was jealous, and was provoked by the anger of his sons and daughters.
And said, I will turn away my face from them, and will show what shall happen to them in the last days. For it is a perverse generation, sons of whom is no faith.
They have provoked me to jealousy with that which is not Yah. They have exasperated me with their idols, and I will provoke them to jealousy with them that are of no nation, and I will anger them with a nation void of understanding.
For fire has been kindled out of my wrath, it shall burn to the hell of blood. It shall devour the land and the fruits of it, and it shall set on fire the foundations of the mountains.
I will gather evil upon them, and I will fight with my weapons against them.
They shall be consumed with hunger and with the
devouring of birds. And there shall be irremediable destruction, and I will send forth against them the teeth of wild beasts, with the rays of serpents on the ground.
Without a sword shall create them of children, and terror shall issue out of the secret chamber. The young man shall perish with the virgin, suckling with him who has grown old.
I said, I will scatter them, and I will cause their glory to cease from among men.
Were it not for the wrath of the enemy, lest they shall live long, lest their enemies shall combine against them, lest they shall say, our own high arm and not Yahuwah has done all these things.
It is a nation that has lost counsel, neither is there understanding in him.
They have not sense to understand. Let them reserve these things against the time to come.
How shall one pursue a thousand, and two rout tens of thousands, if Yah have not sold them, and the Lord
All right. For their gods are not as our God, but our enemies are void of understanding.
For their vine is of the vine of Sodom, and their vine branch of Gomorrah. Their grapes is a grape of gall. Their cluster is one of bitterness.
Their wine is the rage of serpents and the incurable rage of ass.
Lo, are not these things stored up by me, and sealed among my treasures?
In the day of vengeance I will recompense, whensoever their foot shall be tripped up, for the day of destruction is near to them, and the judgments are at hand, are close upon you.
For the Lord shall judge his people, and shall be comforted over his servants. For he saw that they were utterly weakened, and failed in the hostile invasion, and were become feeble.
And Yah said, where are the gods of whom they trusted?
The fat of whose sacrifices ye ate, and ye drank the wine of their drink offerings. Let them arise and help you, and be your protectors.
Behold, that I am he, and there is no God besides me. I kill, and I will make to live. I will smite, and I will heal. And there is none who shall deliver out of my hands.
For I will lift up my hand to heaven, and swear by my right hand, and I will say, I live forever.
For I will sharpen my sword like lightning, and my hand shall take hold of judgment. I will render judgment on my enemies, and will recompense them that hate me.
I will make my weapons drunk with blood, and my sword shall devour flesh. It shall bruise itself with the blood of the wounded. And from the captivity of the heads of their enemies that rule over them.
And together rejoice ye heavens with him.
And let all the angels of Yah worship him. Rejoice ye Gentiles with his people. And let all the sons of Yah strengthen themselves in him. For he will avenge the blood of his sons, and he will render vengeance and recompense
justice to his enemies.
And will reward them that hate him.
And God will purge the land of his people.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So hopefully you can see some of the same things that we were talking about in reference to, you know, how we went through the suffering because we rejected him. And even in the future, he said he's going to take vengeance and he's going to bring us back, even with some Gentiles, right? Yeah. So it's very important for us to understand the meaning of that. If somebody's trying to understand what's going on, that's a good chapter to take to, right? The Psalm of Moses. All right, so we already did praise. This is supposed to be when we did praise and worship, so we will skip over this. So, all right, let's go to the next one. So, time for the bond bands. It's children. So, children, come on up.
All right, up. Hallelujah.
Come on, children. Yeah. Come on.
Hallelujah.
All right.
Come on, get the leaders. Come on.
Yes.
Y'all can remember this? Children's church.
All right.
I'm going to stay right here, baby. Stay with him.
Stay right there.
All right. So, go to the next slide. We're going to learn the books of the Bible. So this is what we're doing. And, you know, parents, y'all better notes. You better be ready because you're going to have to help. All right. So we've been learning the books of the Bible. Oh, come on. All right. So the first thing we're going to do is hold up one finger. Come on. Notes too. Right? So this is the first book of the Bible, Genesis. Right? So we're going to say Genesis.
Genesis.
All right, for the X, Exodus.
Exodus.
L, Leviticus for the law. Numbers. Wiggle your fingers. Count the people. Deuteronomy. I get cooked on that one. Deuteronomy. All right. So now we're going to act like it's a beauty contest, right? You got Joshua, who's the first judge, right? And he's going to judge, right? He's a judge. So Joshua judges. Going to judge a woman, Ruth, because she's part of the beauty contest, right? First Samuel, second Samuel, act like they twins, right? So we just going to say it in the sentence. Joshua, judges, Ruth with 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel. And maybe y'all say,
Joshua, Judges, Ruth with 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel.
All right, so we got the first, at least five. Let's try to go without any slides, all right? Let's see. Y'all ready?
Exodus, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel.
All right. So we got 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel. So then we go to the next one. It's just a repeat. 1 Kings, King on the ground. 2 Kings. All right. Write a story. 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles. All right. So then we get to, so I'm going to write out 2 Chronicles. The next one is, say, come on, y'all, Ezra. Right, so then we put the wall together. We raise the wall up. Nehemiah. All right, turn your head like a beauty contest. Esther.
Esther.
All right, and then it's amazing. Job. And then you raise your hand to praise him. Psalm. All right, so let's see if we can go through that real quick. Let's go back at least one slide. All right, First King. Oh, sorry. First King. Second King. First Chronicles. Second Chronicles. Ezra. Nehemiah. Esther, Job, Psalms. All right, let's go through one more. So we've been already learning some of these, so, you know, this is the next set that we didn't know. All right, stick out your finger like a teacher. Proverbs. And act like you got some electricity. There's no new thing under the sun. Ecclesiastes, you know that old desk is still. Ecclesiastes, no new thing under the sun, right? Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, put the crown on. Isaiah, he saw something, right? He saw the future.
Yeah.
Jeremiah got thrown in the well. Jeremiah got in the well. And then Lamentations, that's like crying. All right, so we're going to stop there, but let's go back one slide. All right, let's say Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations. All right, so let's see if we can start from the very beginning. Some of the parents and the adults help them too, right? We got to show them, so hopefully some of us remember. All right, so let's just go and just start. All right, we're going to take three one time, and then we're going to see if we can do it by itself. All right? All right.
Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy,
Joshua,
First Samuel, Second Samuel, First Kings, Second Kings, First Chronicles, Second Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah.
All right. Let's see who. Dope. Get it dope. Get it dope. Ready enough to try? Come on. Just try. Let's lead the children forward. We also got a time limit, so come on. And I'm free. And that's not for hoes. So we got a bank. We're thankful for hoes when we go down there now, right? So, anybody want to try? Come on. Anybody? Anybody? All right. Thank you.
Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 Kings, 2 Kings, 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, Esther, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther.
Y'all help out. She knew the same with her brothers, right? She's like, hey, where the brothers go? Hold on, son. All right, so y'all needed them, so y'all got them. See how they baba. All right. Come on, together.
Cheers. Figure out
the words of the Ten Commandments. All right, you know, thou shalt not kill, steal, commit adultery. We're already going through some of these. So what is this word for today? All right. So for y'all that's been here for a while, the first we read the Hebrew from right to left. So what's the first letter there? All right, kuf, let's see, kuf. So kuf is like the kuka, Q sound, K sound, K sound. So we got that, all right. Oh yeah, sorry, thank you. And what is the symbol represented? Anybody know? Huh? Oh, thank you, yes. Now, what's some of the meaning of that letter? What does that mean, you know, if you see that symbol? He knows the sun on the horizon, but what else does could it mean?
Condensed circle and time.
All right, let's see. Condensed circle and time. So when we see that symbol, these are the things that should be coming to mind, right?
Yes.
So, you know, this is how we can start breaking down the Hebrew, and that's why we learn ancient, because it actually is kind of like hieroglyphs. It's kind of like a puzzle, right? You don't have to memorize just the symbol. You know, you actually know that symbol has meaning. And as we talked about previously, a lot of these symbols, you know, ancient Hebrew end up being turned to Paleo Hebrew. And from Paleo Hebrew, they took the letters, they switched it from left, going from right to left to right. Saying that right? Yes. And that's what ended up becoming Koine Greek. And then that became alphabet. So English, alphabet. That's where we get the alphabet from, ancient Hebrew, Hebrew put together. All right, so next letter we got, what's the next letter? It looks like a what?
Dog.
And that is a? Door. It looks like a door. Dog, right? So what does that mean? If you think about a door, what does that mean?
Entrance.
Anything else? In.
Hang.
Move.
Yes.
Is this it? I don't have to think. All right. Move, hang, entrance. Door. So when you see that symbol, start thinking about something around that. Something moving, the door, you see people coming out the door is hanging, right? It's an entrance coming in. All right, the next symbol, what is that?
Sheen.
And what is the symbol of?
Two teeth,
bite down, right? So what is that could also mean? You think about teeth, what is teeth? If I put my hand.
To tear.
Pierce. And what is it? Is it bite, but like what's the texture of it? Is it dull or is it
sharp,
right? Let's go to the sharp. You got to press the grind, right? Eat, and you got two front teeth, right? So we know those are the different letters there, all right? So we got the kuf, the dog, and the shin. So if you know, easier way to do it, not saying that this is perfect, but it helps. You can put the like a ah sound. You know, like the olive, kadosh. Anybody know what that could mean? Kadosh. You got the first symbol we talked about, condensed circle time, right? You got something about the door. So something condensed circle time and something about door or entering in or something like that. Something that's there. And then you got the shin, something that's pressing or sharp. Any word that you can think of that could mean that. Now remember, this is the Ten Commandments, right? So that kind of makes it smaller of a selection of words. And if you've been here in previous weeks, you know it's not kill, steal, and adultery and all that. So what do we got left?
Kodesh
means holy. Yes. Right, good. Kodesh. So it means holy. It means set apart, sacred, something separate. You know, we're the holy people. We're the Kadesh people, right? We're the holy people. It means sacred, set apart, all right? So if you think about the first letter, the sun on the horizon, condensed circle time, so anybody can come up with any kind of meaning around that, you know, how could that mean holy or set apart? Think about it, if you're a farmer in the land, and you're trying to say, oh, this is holy, and they see these symbols. What these symbols, how do you put these symbols together to mean holy or set apart? And it's a guess, you know, so don't feel, you know, even I'm guessing, so. So I can see something like, something that's separating, right, from the entrance. Something that is like you have to
press into the entrance, right? Something that is, I'm trying to think about the first letter, how that can be connected. So I can see, you know, you're pressing in the entrance, but how could that mean holy or
you
separate?
You press into the light.
Oh, yeah. The light pressing into the entrance. Yeah, something that's holy. Light is pressing into something, yeah. Or, you know, I'm trying, I know people say it means set apart, so that's what I also was thinking. That's great, yeah. Like I said, there's many different, you know, one word sometimes has different meanings, how it's used in a sentence, so that's great. So it also means set apart, so I'm thinking like the door, the press, and, you know, the light, separate the light from, I don't know, eating? That don't make sense. But, you know, something like that as well. Is that it? All right, so you can see how we're learning these words. So these are the words we learned before. Anybody want to try to take it through it? We got the pronunciation side. But anybody want to take a stab at going through the different ones? Anybody?
You mean just
saying?
Just
saying. So the first one is you got the aleph, which is ah. You got the mem, which is All right.
Ah.
You got the aleph, and you got the bet. Hope I'm getting myself in trouble I'm trying to promise something. All right. Father. You say Abba. That's why I said it was different. All right. Ganav. You got the camel's foot. Gam. You got the noon, which is the seed. And you got the bet, the house. So Ganav. Steal. You're taking something from the house. Right. Those who are the inheritance. You're walking out of the house with something that somebody else's, that their inheritance. All right. Kill. Rod, you have the hay, and then you got the head, which is resh, and then you got the gam, which is like walking, so the spirit of the head that's leaving, kind of think about the spirit leading the body. You got the harab, and then you have adultery. Na'af. Everybody say na'af.
Na'af.
All right, you got noon, you got aleph, and you got hay. So noon is what we said it a few times. Anybody remember what noon means?
Seed.
You got aleph, which means what? Al. Leader, strong strength, right? And then you got hay, which is this. What does that kind of look like? Mouth smiling, right? Sideways smile. So that's the mouth, right? So you got the na'af. Can I say it again? The pa?
Na'af.
Thank you. Na'af. I'm sorry for you up here thinking 10 different things. All right, and then you have covet. What is that?
Kamad.
So you have the het, you have mem, and you have dog. Right? So the chet is kind of like separate. Mem is kind of like the bond. You separate the bond, and you kind of think about it, somebody leaving out the door. Right? You know, your covenant, your covet, you're actually walking in the door, I should say. You're walking in the door. You know, kind of think about a woman that you're separating from family and you're coming to be one of your own. You're bringing that glue together and you basically, you know, kind of take it to the threshold, you know, your covet. Then love.
Ahev.
You got the olive, the, what's next? Olive, the, hey, you know, hey, hey. You got the house, which is,
Bet,
all right. Then dedication, we talked about this, Chinooka. So you got the
it.
None. What's that, hand open?
Cough,
and hey, all right, y'all learning. Then we have Shabbat, which is
Shin,
Bet, Tav, like a, you know, Tav, got the T on cross. Then we got idol, which is, we said was a mouth, like a
pay.
Sin. Mom. Yes, so pay is the mouth. Sin is like sin, destruction, and what's the other? I can't remember what sin means. And then you have mom, which means to lead, or teach, or shepherd. Then you have shem, which is name. You know, we have the
sheen,
which is press, right? Mem. And then we talked about holy or kadesh. We have the kuf,
shin.
All right, so hopefully we continue to remember these, and then eventually we'll
we'll start saying some of the whole phrases, right? We're getting closer. All right, so now we get to the lesson for today. If you got your word with you, make sure you bring it out. Let me raise this so I don't have to pull it down enough. All right, so, you know, it's so important for us to know who we are, and we, you know, today is not going to be one of the longer lessons that we do, because, you know, I feel like I gave enough for you to be able to actually preach a little bit, right? You got to know the word for somebody to preach to you. So if somebody's preaching to you, you don't know what they're talking about, it's just like, you know, kind of like the Charlie Brown thing, right? Womp, 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 womp. You're like, oh, you know, people get up, praise, run around the church and stuff, but they don't have no clue what they're talking about in prophecy. They don't know nothing about who they are. So you got to teach some before you're able to preach. So people got to understand what you're saying. So that's the reason why the Brit Hop Shop, the New Testament, is not very long, like, you know, stuff that was in the Tanakh, the Old Testament, right? Because Tanakh is laying out the foundation a lot. Deuteronomy is long, you know, Psalms is long. But then when you get to the disciples, they have very short books. You know, one of the books to the disciples was James, and it's, you know, Peter, you know, very short, because he's already thinking you understand these concepts. So now that we've been teaching this for a while, months and months, talking about the end times, talking about, you know, we talk about 1 Peter, we talk about the law, we talk about all these things, now it's able to bring it back together and understand where we are right now. And maybe some of those that's on the internet that's looking, maybe you don't even have a clue about any of this. And that's why I want to break it down a little bit to show you why it's important to read the word based upon who you are as the people. So that was the awakening for me because, you know, some of us actually went to church together and we used to read through the Bible once a year. Maybe sometimes he tells us twice. Had to read through two different Bibles in 1 year. So we read the word, but it just wasn't, you know, understanding what it was talking about. Talking about Revelation, talking about Isaiah. What is it talking about? All these different things, right? So now that we can understand some of the concepts that we've been teaching over the last months, years, right now we can maybe can put it together, but once you know who you are, it'll make a lot more sense, right? So just like we're reading the song of Moses, you can kind of imagine now us being the people, you can connect back to slavery, right? Because he said these things were happening in the last days, right? Like these bad things because your forefathers did what's wrong. So now you're like, oh, I can see that happen to our people, right? And then you start reading about losing your understanding, losing your heritage. Do we know our heritage? No. I mean, before today, before we woke up, you know, we were traveling all over the place. You know what I'm saying? We were so many different customs and beliefs, and you know, almost even wearing the what's the thing to call the shirt, the shirt got on. The sheikh, thank you. We wear the sheikh, but we had no clue what it meant. We just put it on because it said black power, right? We had no clue where culture comes from, where it comes from in Africa. We just put stuff on because it's like, let's just hold on to something, right? We don't want to lose everything. Yeah. But then we go put on the suit and ties and stuff like that. Where does the tie come from? We never question that, right? But then when people say we put on fringes, they want to mock us. But like, why you put on a tie? Why you put a piece of fabric around your neck? What's that about? Ain't nothing wrong with it, but I'm saying, like, we should understand why we are doing the things that we're doing and take pride in our own heritage and our own customs, right? Yeah. So that's what we want to make sure that when we read the word and stuff, you know, we want to know why we believe in something. You know, we just don't want to be going around just finding another black identity, but to know that this is your identity. This is you. That when we start talking about this, talking about your ancestors, right? And it's connected to the word. This is our book. It's not just a spiritual, religious thing that can be twisted in so many ways to be used against us in slavery, it can be used in a way that glorifies our people and give our people praise, right? So it's a lot different when you read the word and the child looks and tells you, you know, it's just the money that came off the tree versus knowing that you are a person that's a holy nation that's going to be blessed in the end days. Isn't that a lot different? All our days we walk around with our heads down, you know, like people talking about, I know they're talking about the laws. I've been telling y'all about some of the laws in North Carolina that they've been changing. Just in December, they passed a law where they said that, you know, in schools, they basically are in effect about critical race theory. You don't teach that, or it's limited to what you can teach. But yet, you can see how in the whole world's going to praise what's happening in Israel and say that they're the people. Even though there's some atrocities, and South Africa is trying to say that they're putting up on war crimes, and a lot of people questioning some of the stuff that's going in, but they still say they're the people, you know, they own that land. But what if we the people? What does that mean for our history? They got Holocaust museums all around the world, right?
Because we want to remember the bad things that happened to them so it won't happen again, rightfully so. But what about what happened to our people? Why are they trying to take that out of schools now? So our children won't learn. Maybe there's something about us they don't want us to know. Won't they know where they took us from? You know, you went up there to adopt a child from the hospital, you know what hospital you took them from. So why is it when it's in slavery, and they go to Africa and to Spain to take certain people that's of color and bring them to America, they now don't know where they came from. Documentation of all the stuff that we went over earlier about, like the Igbo tribes, about the different slaves, different tribes and the Ashanti. You know, stuff that, some of these words are coming out of the Bible that these tribes named. But we read it over and over, year by year, never picked that up. Why are we picking it up now? Because there's an awakening, right? So if you saw some of the videos that we put out, you know, the video we put out with the elder from the Limba tribe, he talks about the ingathering, right? So how do people in Israel talk about African Americans, talking about they're part of the lost tribe, but it's wrong for us to talk about it now? There's a hate. It's anti-Semitic for us to talk about our own history and our own culture. Why is that? So we also, in the same sense, some of the churches, black churches, some of the black society, they don't want to hear about that. It's amazing to me when I'm able to ask to speak at working places, to talk about people, and then, you know, I don't hate people. I don't hate other people. I just know who I am, right? That's the only thing I focus on. Whoever you say you are, that's who you are. But I know who I am. So I can speak with boldness, right? Then after I speak, some of the black people, they're like, oh, he's scared. Like, oh, he said too much. I'm like, I'm talking about my family history. How is that wrong for me to talk about my family history? And I'm able to connect the dots back to the slave trade, back to Africa, back to Israel, back to Portugal, back to all these black Portuguese, these black people. But it's wrong for me. But then the amazing piece is that there's Jewish people inviting me to a synagogue. Shouldn't that be the other way around? Shouldn't our people have some pride? So we can see we're still in this mindset of slavery, right? We're scared to talk about who we are. You know, we have prostitutes out there that's suffering from probably generation curses in their family, maybe even touched, raped, or harmed. And now we can't tell them the deliverance is right here. This simple thing that we reject because we say this is the white man's word, right? It's not the white man's word. It's been twisted, but it's twisted with European paganism. You know, we talk about Christmas. Go open the encyclopedia. We talked about that during Hanukkah, right? Go open up Encyclopedia Britannica, look up Christmas. Where did it come from? The worship of Solus Victus, the sun god. Dedicated. This is an encyclopedia. This is not no conspiracy theory 101.com. You know what I'm saying? But it may seem that way, and even our own people would reject you because you talk about these things. Valentine's Day, we talk about St. Nicholas, right? St. Nicholas, they say, had a ring of Cupid on his finger. What is Cupid? Cupid is the god of lust. Now, there's kids in the room, but let's just say this nasty thing. There's a reason why there's a naked baby going around with an arrow. You know, there's something wrong with that, right? So it shows you that a lot of these things. Take out your phone right now. I think we talked a little bit about this. Google the month of January. Put January God and tell me what you can get out of that. Janus. The god looking back, looking to the future, you make resolutions to him. Julius Caesar, what he do? He changed it from March to January because he wanted to honor Janus, the god of new beginnings. Should we be partaking in this? This is not our culture. What about May? Somebody look up May. What's May? Look up May, May God. What is that? So these are things right at our fingers. So this is the time we can see that information is going to ruin to and fro and all this stuff is actually happening. We can see now that we're able to get to this. Anybody find what May means?
God of love.
God of love. And what is the name of the goddess? It should be M-A-I, baby.
Oh, Maya.
And she's God of mothers. What day is Mother's Day? What month is Mother's Day from? Think that's by chance? Father's Day. Wow. There's a father that actually goes to Stonehenge and worship the father's son on Father's Day. You think that's just by chance they did this? Because these days just happened. October 7th, Samhain. And it's just, you know, why can't people who believe in the Bible understand that Halloween is evil? I mean, what? Why was that doing in church? Why are we putting that in churches? Yeah. Isn't there a Kodesh, a separation that we should have as holy people? I don't care if you're an Israelite or what. Shouldn't you have a separation from the world that's preached all throughout the Bible? But yet we assimilate to these things. In the same way as our people in the slave culture, we have assimilated into a slave culture. Right? So that's what y'all was saying. You said these gods that's among you. These can't even back in the day was Canaanite. It was black stuff, right? Hamites. These are Hamites that we assimilate to. Egyptology. You know, a lot of these things that we're trying to go back to Egypt, the same place that we were enslaved, we're trying now to be associated to it, the masonry. All in the churches, but we reject that we're the Israelites, but we're going to accept masonry in the church. A lot of masons are through churches. What about Greeks? Frats. How many frats have you seen inside of a church? Many. They can wear their colors, maybe they got a little program that they have, and you know in their book, there's a book, pro-frat book, that tells you that these are, each frat has an associated Greek god associated to it. You can see it on the Delta Shield, right? You see the little Delta Shield? That's Minerva. Look up Minerva. Just Google Minerva and Isis. Wow. But yet, that's accepted, and this is rejected. Fringes are rejected. You know, us trying to live holy is rejected. If we don't want to eat pork, that's rejected. Why is that rejected, yet the other stuff is accepted within these religious organizations? So now you can see how he wants us to come out of these things, right? You know, it's hard for us to see why we're living in there, but you can see how it's hard for the Israelites, right? Generation after generation of following these false gods in Canaan and Persia. Just think about the names of the people. Mordecai. Y'all know about Mordecai, the book of Esther? You know, he's the one that fought with Haman. He has a Babylon, I think it's a Babylonian or Persian name. And I think it connects back to some god of that place. But yet he was a holy man. So my name is Colwyn Stevens. How did I get the name Stevens? Through slavery, right? But yet I want to stand to be that holy man, that Jay Shear, right? My Jay Shear means upright. I didn't even know this until I graduated from college, put my name in. It's a Hebrew name right in the Bible. You know what I'm saying? So now we call stuff ghetto names. Keisha, Naya. And we're like, oh, I want that name. That's a ghetto name. But Naya? Why we don't want that name? Maya? All these names, Elijah. We say, oh, these names are whatever. Showing our identity of who we are. We should take pride in it. But yet we reject those things and accept the assimilated culture. It's okay to be part of that. And that's the big thing, is that a lot of us are, you know, within our community against our own people. That's the problem. It's not really, you know, people have to say the white man and all that stuff. If we would come together and stop selling out on each other, help out each other, then our people will be lifted where they can't stop us. Why? Because we got a great hallelujah, Yah, right? That's watching over us, protecting us, and want us to come to him to be his people. The holy people, the Mamlekat Kohanim, that holy nation. But it says the kingdom of what? Kingdom of priests. What's a priest? Is that just any common person who just walks around? No, he's the person that's basically saying what's holy, what's not, you know, trying to make sure that the sin stays out of the people. So now he says that you're a priest. Are you doing that in your homes, in your communities, in the things around us? To show that we're that set apart people? To show that we are among the Gentiles? To show that we are holy? Because it says we're supposed to be a witness to the Gentiles. Is our lives a witness to them? Not saying that they want to receive us. Not saying that we're supposed to run around and just, you know, do the things. Because he said, you know, first when Yahushua came, he said, go into the who? The lost sheep of Israel. The Israelites. He said, don't go into the way of the Samaritans, the Gentiles. He said, go find the lost sheep. So, you know, sometimes we've got to make sure, you know, that there's nothing wrong to have a black church, right? Is there a problem to have a Korean church? Chinese church, you got Mexican church, so why is it wrong when we say we want to be Israelites and come among our people and praise and give culture and praise and do the things that we do as part of our heritage? Why is that wrong? You can see how they say anything we do is negative, is hated. So what kind of effect does that have on our children? To feel like, oh, I can't celebrate who I am, just like everybody else is. It's amazing when they have those national days and stuff at schools. You ever seen African flags flying around school? It's more like Spain and stuff like that. They don't put no Nigeria flag and nothing like that. Why is that wrong? Why should our children not be able to be proud at least about Nigeria? You know, we saw we came from the Igbo people. Yeah. Why can't we take that pride in that? Everybody else has a culture, but yeah, with us, be quiet, don't say nothing. It's wrong. You're hateful if you say that you're a special people. But everybody else is saying, right? We do a whole St. Patrick's Day. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with our day? You know, they got an African Liberation Day. We don't need to celebrate it. You know, they celebrate in Ireland. A white country celebrates African Liberation Day, and we're Africans in our captivity, and we don't need to celebrate Liberation Day. Mandela Day. All these things around, you know, what's his name? Can't think of his name. But he actually met with Martin Luther King. They met together and talked about how he wanted, Martin Luther King wanted African Americans to go back to Ghana in the last couple of days of his life. Because he knew, he said his dream has turned into a nightmare. And you hear people talk about that. Here's Martin Luther King. You ever say, oh, no, we have a dream, but it turned into a nightmare. No, they don't say that. And why did it turn into a nightmare? Because he saw that our people, even though we got our freedom, we decided to assimilate and come away from our own stuff. So we're no longer building up our own businesses. And people are like, oh, that's wrong, Martin Luther King did that. What? But y'all still want to get beat and hung and raped at night and, you know, have no laws against you, not be able to vote? That's crazy. That's crazy for people to say that. But now he gave us the freedom to do something. What did we decide to do? Be assimilated back to a culture that's not ours. But he gave us the freedom and the choice to do it. And now we have the choice to decide to still go back to the world, to the things of the world. And y'all, you know, was telling even through his disciples, don't be like the world. Come out of the world. But yet we still get sucked in. And you can see that even in our culture, you know, rap and R&B. Every time I know early rap, it was rejected so bad, right? Everybody like, oh, that's bad rap. You know, it was terrible. Newscasters and everybody else. And then what happened? You had Eminem. You had some of those Vanilla Ice. You know, Ice, baby. Everybody, oh. You know, it's like moving over. Everybody sees the newscast, ice, baby. You know, it's like, what is accepting that? What made it accepted? It was all hated, NWA and all that stuff. And now, it's like, oh, yes, my children look at, what's that, what is it? Ooh, whoop, there it is. Oh, yeah, whoop, there it is. You know, it's like, what? So, you know, seeing how we woke up and think about even our elders, you know, how they saw during the time of civil rights, and now they're seeing stuff now. You know, I'm sure their mind is even blown, you know, about how the sin is even messed even in our own families, you know, when they don't respect elders, when they used to respect elders, even, you know, some of us youth leaders that's here. When I started youth church, man, I said, I tell your mama, boy, they sit up, they stop talking. Around the end, so I'm going to tell your mama. My mom told me I had to be here. I'm like, what? Get out. Don't come back in until I talk to your mama then. You know, it's like a whole different attitude is coming among our people, but our culture was what? Holy, respectable. And now we got so far away from that because we were told so many times it's wrong. Now they're telling you now, you can understand how in the Bible they said Israel's done away with. Right? That's what they say now. Old Testament theology, you know that the early slaves, they even went to church. Remember, we were forced to actually adapt to the culture, right, in America. Now, in South America stuff, they were still doing all the voodoo and all that kind of stuff. But over here, we were forced to adapt to the, you know, Christian Protestant culture or whatever culture. Even, you know, there was equal amount of people that was Jewish, as you saw in the video, hopefully y'all watched, that they said that we worked for some Jewish were slaves, were enslaved, right? And then we adapted to some of those cultures. So now you can see why some Israelite people have some Jewish cultures and customs within them that's found in the Bible, right? Light candles and, you know, the cedar plate and stuff. That's not in the Bible. And Passover says, don't get a cedar plate. Where does that come from? You know, the 9-candle menorah during Hanukkah. This is Judaism, right? So why are we adapting to that when it's not in the Bible, right? So, you know, it's because we're living even in slave culture. But yet, we can see how Yah has plans for his people. And in the New Testament, people act like there's no mention of Israel waking up to be his people. So let's go to the next slide. We're going to go through some scriptures real quick. Y'all still with me? Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It says, let's turn to Romans 11. Actually, let's turn to Romans 10 first, because I want to make sure people know that scripture is for all people. It's not just for Israel. So, you know, we got to make sure we talk a little bit about that before we start talking about us. People can't say we haters and all that kind of stuff, right? Because we know that the Gentiles are also important, that he has a way for them. He says he's light unto the Gentiles, so how can he reject the Gentiles, right? So we turn to Romans 11, and we're going to talk about the Deuteronomy 32. Then we just read the Song of Moses. Yeah. Let's see if we mention, you know, I went through this before, but I'm going to see if anybody can see that part about the Deuteronomy 32. Let me see. Somebody read verses 18 through 21. Romans chapter 10, 18 through 21.
But I said, surely they have never heard, have they? Indeed, they have. Their voice has gone out into all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. But I say, surely Israel did not know, did they? First, Moses says, I will make you jealous by that which is not a nation. By a nation without understanding will I anger you. And Isaiah is very bold and says, I was found by those who did not seek me. I became manifest to those who did not ask for me. But as for Israel, he says, all the day long I have stretched out my hands to a disobedient and obstinate people.
All right, thank you. So anybody can see what we just read in Deuteronomy 32? See any verses there? So one of the clues is the person who said that. Who was talking to Deuteronomy?
Moses.
Okay, you see anyone that's passage where it says Moses?
Yes.
And what did it say about Moses?
I will make you jealous. That which is not a nation.
That's not a nation. So what is he talking about? So hold that spot. Let's go back to Deuteronomy 32. And let's look to see if that is anywhere in this song of Moses. Right? Let me see. Let me get to it. Yes. Would you read chapter 32, verse 21? You read that, Elder?
Yes. And they have made me jealous with what is not Elohim or God. They have provoked me to anger with their idols, so I will make them jealous with those who are not a people. I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation.
So right there, you know, as part of the Song of Moses, he told us what he was going to do. He said he's going to bring these Gentiles because we rejected him. He's going to pull in more people because he created everybody from Adam, right? He cares about everybody. But yet, does that mean Israel is done away with? No. Paul says in the next chapter, you know, I say then y'all have not rejected what? His people. Has he? He asked the question. He has not rejected his people. May it never be. So how can Paul say that Israel is done away with? Why do they teach that in the Christian church, that Israel is now a spiritual Israel and they're done away with? When he just talked to the Gentiles about them coming in because of the disobedience of the Israelites, but then he says, Yah has not rejected his people. May it never be. For I too am an Israelite. Did he say I too am a Ishmaelite or just a Hebrew? No, he says I'm an Israelite. Right? A descendant of Abraham of the tribe that he broke down. He even went down more specified the tribe he comes from. Benjamin, right? Yah has not rejected his people who he foreknew. He foreknew us even in the Song of Moses, right? He said we're going to be a people. He said he's going to bring us back. Vengeance is going to happen and everything else. So why is that wrong for us to talk about? If we're the people. So hopefully this is showing you a different lens that now you're looking at the word that, you know, make a little bit more sense when you start looking at the people that's been subjugated, that have been brought down, that have been enslaved. Even the Bible says, is Israel a homeborn slave? Because all the nations have enslaved Israel. You think from the very beginning, the Babylonians and the Syrians, the Persians, you know, even the Romans and the Greeks, and then even the people of Spain, Portuguese. They're enslaved. People don't even talk about it. That's why they call you a Negro, because that's a Spanish or Portuguese word. Slave trade started in Seville, Spain, not in Africa. They took black people out of Spain and took them to the Dominican Republic. That was the first slave that came to America. But they should tell you about the African, right? Just the African people that came out. They don't talk about the Spanish and Portuguese that were called black Portuguese Jews that were enslaved before, that was part of the Spanish Inquisitions, and that ended up was taken out of the land and sent to a slavery, they had gold and big houses and all that stuff, and you act like you had nothing before. So that's why we want to do DNA. That's why we want to look at your genealogy. We're showing you some stuff that they're not telling you. Alright? So it says, or do you not know what the scripture says in the passage about Elijah, how he pleased with God against Israel In the same way then, there has also come to be at the present time a remnant according to God's gracious choice. So he said even through all that, there's still some people that he's going to preserve from up to the end time to come from the tribe of Israel. Says it right there. This is Paul. I'm not even coming out of the Old Testament, as they try to say. They try to say the slaves had an Old Testament Christianity back in the day. What is an Old Testament Christianity? They sent missionaries from the north to change the southern people, the old country, Christians, to change our religion to be more New Testament. Wait, if you're a Christian, ain't you a Christian? What's the difference? Because they were separating that Turner, right, from these Old Testament scriptures. They took this slave Bible and tore out certain scriptures so you can't identify with the people of the Bible, right? Because reading, that's what the slave Bible is. So it says, what then? What Israel is seeking, it has not obtained, but those who are chosen obtained it. And the rest were hardened. So he just says that just because you're Israel don't mean you're going to heaven. Because some of us hearts are hardened. You can see it among our communities, right? Yeah. We promote what's bad, and we push those who's doing right to the side, right? Those, if you want to make it, you got to sell your body, you got to be half naked as a woman, or you got to be a man that goes around and talks about your community and talk about drugs and gangs and violence. And that you can make it if you do those things, once you destroy your own community, right? You can be on TV and do a movie that's about rated R, rated X, right? That's accepted. That's, we made it, right? I remember that movie, what was it, Killing the Bee? They said it was rated G or something? And they put a cuss word in it so they can get to a better audience. Child movie? So we gotta really watch what our children watch, right? Because that's what they want, is the truth, real. I'm gonna tell you. You go ahead and praise God and be, oh yes, and then die, and then your children gonna be in sin, and they're like, oh, that's what we want. We got your children. You go ahead and do whatever you want, but when you get your children, we know we got next generation, everybody else that we can bring up in a sinful culture and still have you separated for what brings you power. Yeah. So, it says in verse 13, it says, but I was speaking to you who are what? He's speaking to the Gentiles and saying that Israelites are still important. He said, don't get too big-headed. In as much then as I am an apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry. Going to verse 25, for I do not want you brethren to be uninformed of this mystery, so that you would not be wise, and that you will not be wise in your own estimation, that a partial hardening has to happen to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come. What does that mean? What is the fullness? So he brought Gentiles in, but are Gentiles doing right now by him?
Nope.
So he said he brought some of them in, now he's going back to Israel. So all Israel will be saved, just as it is written, deliver will consume from Zion, he removed ungodliness from Jacob. From the standpoint of the gospel, they are the enemies for your sake, but from the standpoint of God's choice, they are beloved for the sake of the fathers, for the gifts and the callings of God are irrevocable. So he's saying that for the Gentiles, thankfully we reject them because now they've come in, but he said, no, God still got a hold on to them, those people, to you. It's a lot different, right? When he says you, instead of us thinking we Gentiles that just came off of a plantation that just came out of some trees swinging in Africa, and now we just happen to have the Bible because this white Jesus is before us, and we just need to bow down to him, right? That's the mindset that we got now. But what if it said, oh, this is your promise, and the only thing you have to do is wake up to it, and you can enter into who you were before? That's a whole different perspective, right? So now let's look at, you know, he says, when we say the NSB, when it's capitalized, what does that mean? It's in the Tanakh. It's in the Old Testament, right? So what scripture is that? Anybody ever talk about what scripture that is in the church that you heard that somebody preach from? They ever go to these scriptures in the Old Testament? Oh, that's Old Testament Christianity. You can't do that. That's slave mentality, right? Just can't open the Bible and go to the Old Testament and look at those pages, right? That's wrong. You know, so let's go to the Old Testament and see what that is. All right? Yeah, so you can see in Isaiah 59, 20 and 21, you can see the same thing. A redeemer will come to Zion, and to those who have turned from my transgression in Jacob. Who is Jacob? Israel, right? Declares Yahuwah. As for me, this is my covenant with them. Y'all, we got a covenant. We got a covenant with Israel. Not with the whole world. There's a covenant with them too. But there's one particular for Israel. Says Yahuwah. My spirit which is upon you and my words which I have put in your mouth shall not depart from your mouth, nor from the mouth of your offspring. Are we the offspring of Jacob? Mm-hmm. So this is for you. You ever looked at it that way? You read the Bible, that this is for me, the scripture's for me. Or you rush through it like we did back in, you know, I said we were reading through the Bible every year, thankfully. And we saw scriptures, but we were like, oh, yeah, that's interesting. That's for those Jewish people, right? Let's go to the next chapter. Okay, you know, like, no, this is for you. This is the scripture for you. This is your covenant, right? From the mouth of your offspring's offspring. Offspring's offspring. What is that? Even our grandchildren and other people forever. You said he wanted to make sure that was clear, right? It says Yahuwah from now and forever. Does forever mean forever? So does eternal life mean eternal life? So forever means forever, right? All right, so let's read Isaiah 59, and then we'll come to a close. But this is so important, because now we can start seeing in the lens of Paul. This is what Paul says, right? Is Paul preaching out of context? No. Hopefully not, right? We know he's an Israelite, he's an apostle. Hopefully he knows these scriptures. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees, right? He was ascending under some of the top teachers, so he should know that he's not preaching out of context. So let's read what he says. Will somebody read verses 1 through 3 so I don't lose my voice.
Behold, Yahuwah's hand is not so short that he cannot save, nor his ear so dull that he cannot hear. But your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers are iniquity. Your lips have spoken falsehood, your tongue mutters wickedness. No one sues righteously, and no one pleads honestly. They trust in confusion and speak lies. They conceive mischief and bring forth iniquity. They hatch adder's eggs and weave the spider's web. He who eats of their eggs dies, and from that which is crushed, a snake breaks forth. Their webs will not become clothing, nor will they cover themselves with their works. Their works are works of iniquity, and acts of violence is in their hands. Their feet run to evil, and they hasten to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are the thoughts of iniquity, devastation, and destruction are in their highways. They do not know the way of peace, and there is no justice in their tracks. They have made their paths crooked. Whoever treads on them does not know peace. Therefore, justice is far from us, and righteousness does not overtake us. We hope for light, but behold darkness, or brightness, but we walk in gloom. We grope along the wall like blind men. We grope like those who have no eyes. We stumble at midday as in the twilight. Among those who are vigorous, we are like dead men.
Thank you. So doesn't that sound a lot about our community? Yeah. You ever go to bad place full of minorities, us, our people, and they just walk around aimlessly? You see them on drugs, or, just out of their minds and stuff. Some neighborhoods some of us might have sometimes grew up in, right? Don't you hear the gunshots? I remember being up in Goldsboro, sitting on the floor of my house, and you hear gunshots about every night. And I'm coming, from a place in Virginia, and I'm in there hearing gunshots, and I get used to it. It becomes adjusted, because that's what the neighborhood was. I was fearful when I first got there, but I got adjusted to it. It wasn't nothing, because I accepted the evil that was among me. I thought that was right. And I think about some of our children that's growing up in some of these places that can't get peace, don't have food, have problems in their lives, and nobody's reaching out to them. Nobody in our community, nobody has an extra dollar that they can give my children some shoes and your children some shoes. This is who we are, we're supposed to be, but are we being that kind of people? Are we just worried about our own selves? That's assimilate to a culture that's not ours. That's not the holiness that he wants us to be as a community, as a kingdom of priests. Those priests are supposed to go around and make sure people are taken care of, right? You can't adopt one child to make sure that they take care of one child. You can't give a little bit of something that you gave to your children. We give to our children all kinds of stuff growing up. You can't give something to another child. So that's the kind of mindset that he wants us to have as his called out holy kingdom of priest people. And you can see how it says we walk in the dark. And Cousin Keisha was talking about it, even with the word Kodesh, the sun is separated from the door, bring that light in, right? We press that light in our lives, but yet we live in darkness. And you can see that in our midst of our people. So what are we going to do about it? We're just going to talk and just have service and come praise y'all and go home and like, oh, that was good. Or we're going to do something about it. Yeah. And it starts with you. What's the two greatest commandments that Yahushua said? So we doing the y'all part, but what about the neighbor part? As yourself? We're not doing that. So this is the thing that we must do. Nobody needs to oversight, make sure you do it. You just do it because you want to do it. Because you're part of the kingdom. Yeah. You want your people to wake up and be part of the kingdom too. Yeah. That's what we need to be looking at in these days and times. But you know, it says that how we more about violence. And you know, who eats the eggs, dies, and talking about, you know, the snake eggs, the adder eggs and stuff. Causing problems, weaving confusion in our own people's lives. You know, a lot of times, a lot of issues that we had to see the drama on TV, right? Especially some of those women shows, you know, they call them issues and call them backbiting and stuff. You know, women's psychological. Guys is fighting is over, but women, oh my.
Yeah.
You better, oh man. Working some of those kids in the church, these two girls be fighting, and we like, by the time we talk to them, they friends, they fighting somebody else. We're like, what? You know, they done teamed up on somebody else and it's psychological too, so we can't find the two boys so I can just break that up. Girl, they be like, you know, I'm gonna get hurt, I'm thinking I'm gonna put it on Facebook, I'm gonna make it look bad, I'm gonna take a boyfriend. I'm like, what in the world? What time since all that, you know? It's like, what are you like, man, you tired. So we gotta make sure that we also make sure we present these same things before our daughters and nieces and grandchildren and all. We gotta make sure that they see the things in our life and they hear us whisper. You want to find something that's going on in your community? Talk to the children. Because people don't have stuff in front of children. Me and my wife, we just talking about, like, we have a thing called kids zone. And some of those kids come in, they're like, my mom, I'm like, oh, wait a minute, let's stop that. Let's stop that. My daddy, I saw Deacon so-and-so. What was it, MySpace back then? Well, MySpace, why is he so-and-so kissing and they married? I'm like, oh, well, baby. You know? So, you want to know something, talk to the children. They see these things and what's happening, they're going to grow and be that way. Yeah. They think it's accepted. Well, you did it. Yeah. You know, I saw D so-and-so do it. So this starts with us. That's how we want to change the nation of people, is making sure that we do the thing that's holy and righteous before them. And that's what I'm talking about, us being that example. So this darkness is overtaking our people. This sin is overtaking us. And how do we fight against that? I live by the law. That's why he says in the New Testament, those, you know, Yahushua said those who are lawless are not going to make it to heaven. They have no direction, no hope. Now, we can't go in there and stone people, kill people, and all the stuff the Bible tells us to do, because now we don't have a temple, it's not supposed to be part of that, and it's not just the law of legalism. Because he said now that if you don't surpass the righteousness of the Pharisees, that you won't make them to heaven. The Pharisees were very legalistic. They had laws on top of the laws that to make sure they don't break the laws. And then if you break that law, there was punishments for laws that was made up. Right? So now he's saying that it's not, yeah, your righteousness has to precede them because it's got to be from your heart. You got to want to do it. You know, thou shalt not commit adultery is a law. But y'all my sisters. I shouldn't want to be lusting after y'all. You know what I'm saying? I got a beautiful wife myself. How does she want to feel?
All right.
You know what I'm saying? I don't want that to be done to my daughter. Same thing with the women. You shouldn't be lusting after another woman's man.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? These are the things that we got to messes up our society, our community, and everything else. Then we wonder why we're so messed up, right? We want to pick on the other child's, you know, somebody else's child, but we don't want nobody to take it to our child. You know what I'm saying? In the same love, you should rebuke that child just like you should your own, but in the same sense, you got to be in love. And that's why we don't have trust, you know, back in the day, to go walk and take some braces and pump off somebody's tree. By the time I get home, grandma knew about it. Because she didn't call, and I know your grandma, I know your mama, you know what I'm saying? We don't have the kind of sense of community anymore. You know, we see this child going through the park or through the at the mall and, you know, doing something wrong. We won't even call and tell the parents and say nothing. Because number one, we're scared. As soon as we tell them, they're going to go off and act like you're the one that's wrong, right?
Yeah.
So why do we do that now in our communities? You know? Even if they call us out and call our child, I should be like, thank you. Even if they did it in the evil intentions, I at least know I can save my child, right? And they want to be judged for what they do. But we know, I'd rather you tell me before it goes all over Facebook and the whole world knows except for me, or Snapchat or some of those things that, you know, parents don't have a clue what's going on, but everybody else in the community does. Because why? That child going to see your child do it. They're going to tell their mama, look at so-and-so, you know, look at them doing it. And then they're going to spread it to other people, and that child don't even know what's going on. And they go to an interview, ain't you so-and-so child? I think I saw a picture of you on Snapchat. You know what I'm saying? And that's what they're doing. I mean, just from an internet standpoint, recruiters are doing that now. Nothing. As soon as you put it out there, it doesn't get deleted. It's there forever. So we have to be very careful how we deal with our children on the internet and all that. That's another subject. Let's go to the next slide. Let somebody read the rest of it. So this is where the scripture talks about comes from. And Romans that we just read, right? So we just read, this is Paul, he's talking about this in context, right? So we just talked about how the evil part that happened among our people and how we separated because of our sin. So if we want to get back right, we need to make sure that evil stops by getting our connection back to him. And the only way we can do it through is Yahushua HaMashiach, right?
Yeah.
The Messiah. So let's talk about the other part. Somebody read 11 through 21 for me, please.
So all of us growl like bears. Savage like doves. We hope for justice, but there is none. A salvation, but it's far from us. For our transgressions are multiplied before you, and our sins testify against us. For our transgressions are with us, and we know our iniquity. Transgression and denying Yahuwah, and turning away from our Elohim, speaking oppression and revolt, conceiving in and uttering from the heart lying words. Justice is turned back. Righteousness stands afar off. The truth has stumbled in the streets, and uprightness cannot enter. Yes, truth is lacking, and he who turns aside from evil make himself a prey. Let me read that again. And he that turns aside from evil make himself a prey. Now Yahuwah saw it and was displeasing in his sight, but there was no justice, and he saw that there was no man. He was astonished that there was no one to intercede. Then his own arm brought salvation to him, and his righteousness upheld him. He put on righteousness like a breastplate, and a helmet of salvation on his head, and he put on garments of vengeance for clothing, wrapped himself with zeal as a mantle, according to their deed, so he will repay wrath to his adversary, recompense to his enemy, to the coastlands he will make recompense. So they will fear the name of the Most High from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun. For he will come like a rushing stream, which the wind of Yahuwah drives. A redeemer will come to Zion, and those who turn from transgression in Jacob declare the Most High. As for me, this is my covenant with them, says Yahuwah. My spirit which is upon you, and my word which I put in your mouth shall not depart from your mouth, nor from the mouth of your offspring, nor from the mouth of your offspring's offspring, says the Most High, from now and forever.
So you can see in context, thank you. You can see in context what that means now, right? So if you read through the New Testament, if you don't have this concept, the thing that Israel is done away with. But we are very important. He's telling us what's going to happen. This is the map for us to get back to where we need to be. This holiness is righteousness. And even he talks about how we try to do right, as Elder was talking about, we're the ones that say, no, you sound like a white boy. You know what I'm saying? You talk proper and educated, oh, you sound like a white girl. Like, why do we do that to our people? Education is bad? You got to talk like Ebonics in order to be respected. You know what I'm saying? So we need to change that. You know, when we see somebody that's trying to do right, let us, you know, push behind them, say, good job. Let's encourage our youth, our young adults, each other. When we try to do business, let us help each other honestly. You know, we should be partnering with each other for stuff so then when we able to get blessed, we can go on to do something else and continue to do well. You know, that's how the Jewish community does it. And I ain't knocking that. It's like they come together, you know, five people come together and buy a car, right? Go sell that car and give me about $5,000 profit. You got five people, $5,000 profit, how much everybody just made? $1,000. Take that same $5,000, go buy another car. Now you got $10,000. Then you put the $10,000, you might buy a little house. Now you get more profit. And you continue to do that until now everybody got their own money.
fine, they can go their separate ways and do, you know, for their families and everything else. But we don't trust, you know, most of the time somebody looking for somebody on to come do something at their house. I don't know that black man. I don't Hakeem, I might get a pass that name. He might jack up my house. Why we think like that? Not Hakeem. Don't get Hakeem over here. He gonna jack it. Don't know the man. Don't know get 5-star rating. Oh, Hakeem. I don't know. It's like we look at our community like that, and sometimes it's justifiable, right? Yes. It's like, but why do we do that to each other? But then when we get business from somebody else and they jack us up, well, you know, he's Billy, he tried to help me, but you know, we kind of, it's okay. We ain't gonna take him to court. But Hakeem messed up, I'm taking you to court. You know, today one of them, you messed up, you didn't cut that edge of my side bush way out on the other acre, so I'm gonna take you to court. But stuff that's done wrong right there, oh, really, oh, okay, thank you, next time. So it's like not trying to impress other people, but with our own people, we need to work with each other. You know, if you got a business and you're doing something wrong, we need to say, hey, man, you know, I want to keep on doing business with you, but your prices are high, man. You know, what can we do to get your prices down? You know what I'm saying? Or I understand you might have to charge me extra $2, you know, but I ain't going to run to Walmart because you should charge me extra $2 because Walmart is just pricing everybody out. And if Walmart closed down, that whole community goes down. That's right. As we see what's going on with the Chicago places, closing up Walmart, all the other stores closed. Now they got to go miles and miles to get their food. But if they had Hakeem, the farmer, you know, going to Hakeem the farmer, they could have some produce and help Hakeem have a Walmart Hakeem place. Hakeem Mart. But, you know, these are the things that we must need to do, and it starts with seeking him, because once we seek him, then our morals are right. That's the thing, our morals, our righteousness, our holiness. Those are the things that we must do, because then we can work with each other, trust each other, do the things, but until we turn to do what's righteous, how are we going to trust each other?
Yes.
So hopefully, I'm preaching to the choir. Hopefully, I'm preaching to the choir, right? So these are the people I'm preaching to on Facebook, not in that room. So when we actually work together, let us be diligent and do things that we know we need to do and help out each other. You know, here we are right here in ministry. I was sweating. We got anybody going to step up next week? Read something. Do something. You know, we got your young men doing stuff. We got people doing stuff all around us. Where are you going to fit in this? It's not about J. Shear's ministry. It's not my ministry. It's ours. We're one people. So where do you fit in? We need somebody might can register somebody. We're talking about evangelism. We're talking about all these different things. Where do you fit into the kingdom of God as a priest? So, with that said, now that we can see ourselves, then he talks about how he's going to intercede, right? He's going to have a helmet of salvation. Y'all heard of a helmet of salvation anywhere? Ain't that in the New Testament, right? The garments, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the belt of truth. Y'all heard anything? But this is not the New Testament. What is this? This is the Tanakh, right? Old Testament. So, why do we have like these new concepts that just comes into the New Testament? So we gotta make sure we understand where some of these words come from the context, and when we know who we are, then we can read stuff. So just open your Bible, man. We ain't going through all these scriptures. But let's just see, we just read Isaiah 59, right? Let's go to Isaiah 60. Let's just read a few chapters. With us as knowing who we are as Israelites, knowing our customs, somebody just read 5 verses. I'm just going something out.
60, right?
60, yes, 1-5. Just read those. Think about who we are.
Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of Yahuwah has risen on you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness to people. But Yahuwah shall rise on you, and his glory shall be seen on you. Verse 3. And nations shall walk to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawns. Oh, no, not dawn, dawning. Verse 4. Lift up your eyes all around and see. They are all assembling. They are coming to you. Your son shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be supported on the side. Verse 5. Then you shall fear and be bright, and your heart shall dread and swell. For the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you, the wealth of nations shall come to you.
Now, read a little different if you're Israelite.
No longer you can walk like this, children. You can walk like this.
Hallelujah.
I know who I am.
Hallelujah.
The wealth is going to come to me. Not just a significance of who I am. I'm important.
Yes.
Let's go just read something else. Let's go to 61. Let's go home. I mean, read that whole chapter. You're like, this is me? So let's go to 61. Somebody read through verse 6 through, I'm just picking something, to 10. I'm just 6 to 10. Somebody read that for us.
But you shall be named priests of Yahuwah. Men shall call you ministers of my Elohim. You shall eat the riches of other nations, and in their glory shall you boast yourselves. For your shame you shall have double, and for your confusion they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land they shall possess the double. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. For I, Yahuwah, love judgment. I hate robbery for a sin of smoke offering, and I will direct their work in truth, and I will cut an everlasting covenant with them. And their seed shall be known among other nations, and their offspring among the people. All that see them shall acknowledge them, that they are the seed which Yahuwah has blessed.
Look right there. Offspring is laughing and walk with their heads up, right? Let's go to 62. Read 1 through 5. Somebody just read the first 5 verses. Chapter 62, 1 through 5.
For Zion's sake, I am not silent. And for Jerusalem's sake, I do not rest until her righteousness goes forth as brightness and her deliverance as a lamp that burns. And the nation shall see your righteousness and all sovereigns your esteem. And you shall be called by a name, new name, with the mouth of your own designates. And you shall be a crown of comeliness in the hand of your Lord, and a royal headdress in the hand of your Elohim. No longer are you called forsaken, and no longer is your land called deserted, but you shall be called Hephzibah, and your land married, and your Lord shall delight in you, and your land be married. For as a young man marries a maiden, so shall your sons marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your Elohim rejoice over you.
Thank you. So you can see now, these are promises. Now when you read that scripture, it reads a little different. You know? And I was stepping through before. I was like, just get through this. Leviticus is nothing. I'm just trying to get through. You know, but when you start reading Genesis chapter 10, the table of nations tell you where all these nations come from. Right? And it talks about Jacob, right? It said Jacob has a descendant by the name of Magog. We go to Revelations and it says the devil will be released and deceive Gog and Magog. So it's telling us that this is a nation that's living on the earth now that is dangerous. Is that racist? It's the Bible says it. It's true. But when we were those evil nations that people used to talk about, you know, it says we're supposed to go into the land. Then the Moabites and the Ammonites are against us. We're going to swoop down on the Philistines. Who are these people now? So it shows us what's going on. Everybody has an enemy, right? During the time of the Holocaust, who are the Holocaust enemies? Nazis, right? Germans, right? During the time when the Greeks were invading the land of the Middle East and stuff, who were the Egyptians' enemies? The Greeks, right? The Greeks' enemies were the Egyptians. So now we're talking about Israel, and the enemies are who? Hamas, right? They're a nation of people, right? But that's the enemies of Israel. So who are our enemies? Don't we got enemies?
Yes.
So it's important to know who these people are. But the Bible tells us in the last days, it's important to know who your enemies are. And we begin with that because next, you know, that's when we're going into the end time. So we'll continue next week with our study on the end times. And it's very important that we understand who we are because of what's going around us. So let us stand real quick. So it's just important now to come together. A lot of time in the Israelite gatherings, we don't think about self-personal placement and conviction, right? So as we come here today, it's not just to know knowledge, just Gnostic, just to have more knowledge in your head. Right? It's about a heart change. And that's what we come here. That's the reason why we gather, so we can continue to assemble not just Israelites, but Israelites who know who they are in a holy way. The righteous kingdom. Right? So let us pray. Dear God, we just thank you for this time. We ask you just to help us in our daily life. We ask you to just be with us as we know that you have everyone here for a reason. And, you know, we just thank you for them to be part of the nation that's waking up. not only to Israelite, being Israelites, but also waking up to a better relationship with you. Yeah. If there's anybody in there here that hasn't had that true relationship with Yahusha, who hasn't truly given their lives, their souls unto him, we ask you just to come together today, come up so us to pray for you. It's not for us to lay hands and throw oil on you. This is your acknowledgement before the assembly that you need, you want a closer walk with him. Yes. And that's what this is all about. So if there's anybody in here that needs that closer walk, that desires that walk, that haven't truly given their life over to the Messiah, please come forward today for us just to pray with you, because we love you. And it says we want to make sure that you acknowledge him before men, because he wants to acknowledge you, you know, Yahushua wants to acknowledge you before the Father. So if anybody's out there, I just don't want to just guess and think that there's somebody who hasn't, but if it's you, just come forward and we'll pray with you. Is there anyone? All right, so if there's anyone out there that just wants a better relationship, know that you might have went backwards a little bit, now you want to move forward ahead, that you want, maybe you don't have clarity in everything, you're trying to really grasp these concepts, you know, or maybe you have somebody else in your family that's going through and you want to stand as a place for them, please come forward and let us just have prayer. Is there anybody? Thank you. Everybody should reach their hands out towards them. Come on, baby. All right. Dear Yah, we ask you just to be with them in the times of their need. You see that they are bold enough to come before you with their needs, for their family needs, and whatever's going on in life, you know. You know, we all don't even know everybody's business. We just give it unto you, for you know it even better than they know it. So we ask you to intervene on their behalf, give them favor, help them to even have a closer walk with you, and even with those that surround them, help them to be a light to them, to affect them, to impact them, for them to see the things that you're doing in their lives, so they want to be a part of this as well, be a part of you through your son, Yahushua HaMashiach. We thank you for all the things that you're going to do in their life. You know what's going on. We ask you just to help those walls to go down, and for your true light to come in, your Kadesh, your holiness, your set apartness. Help that be seen on their lives and those that they affect, for we know that you call us to be priests, and we ask you for your favor to just change situations, change our environment, change whatever they're going through in their own personal life and the lives of others. We just thank you for them coming and to be a representative of that and representative of your kingdom, and ask you to be with them as they go back to those that they might have to influence. We love you and we praise you in Yahushua HaMashiach's name. Give them favor in Yahushua's name. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you. All right, so, come on, baby. All right, so, we know we have to be out of here a little bit, so that's why I'm moving kind of fast, but I think that, you know, today's service went well. We got like 15 minutes to go, and next slide, you know, we're trying this out. This is what we're trying out for the next 4 weeks, so, you know, we're going to have money to do this, right? So if you want to give to anything, you know, I don't try to force anybody, because I know everybody's on different paths, different planes, different positions in their life. But if there's something that you want to give, you know, please come see me afterwards, or, you know our different donations with Cash App, and go to the website, somewhere, memberkitcornine.org, if you know that's out there on Facebook, go to memberkitcornine.org, and, you know, we have different ways to give. You give us to one of the members, you know, for $25. You know, we're not assemblies and scarf tithes and offering, but some people still give their tithes to us, and that's great. You know, I think that's part of who we are. There is tithing as part of scripture, you know, as well. So it's about building up our own community. My brother sent me something where one of the Israelites were trying to go to a bank, right? And then they were rejected, and they couldn't understand why they were rejected, because they went to a Christian bank. Like, they're Christian. They're going to support Israelite stuff. So who is going to support Israelite stuff? They got stuff for Christians. Who do we go to? But that's why God put in his words and steps, tithing and offering, in order for us to prepare and be able to do stuff, not only for what we're doing here, but even in Africa and all around. So that's the reason why he wants to put those things forth. And I'm not a person who likes to talk a lot about money, so hopefully one day I'll step up here next time to do this. Because I don't want people to think it's all about money, right? But we gotta have money. This thing wasn't for free, right? Somebody did give us a building, so that's the reason why I want us to make sure we're able to do that before, you know, we go in there and, you know, kind of embarrass ourselves with other people. So, you know, this is very important, and if you want to give, you know, I'm not going to keep on talking about it, but go to the website, you can see stuff. I know some of y'all gave away for shirts and stuff, but maybe the last time, you know, the fourth time, hopefully they're very slow about sending shirts, but maybe one day we should all wear our shirts and walk in here and write in, like, what's all these people with these shirts? So, you know what I'm saying? That's the way that you can evangelize as well. I mean, for those who are able to buy it, I'm not trying to put pressure on you. Wear a white t-shirt, you know, as well. If you got proper money, let me know. We're the kingdom, right? We want to make sure that we take care of our people. So, you know, it's not just with those who can pay, get the dollar, get the golden chair and stuff like that, the silver chair, the bronze seating. We ain't doing that kind of stuff, right? Because we know there's people out there that's hurting, and it says if you be partial to certain people, right, it's a sin. We don't do partiality, right? So, you know, poor person sit right here, or a rich person sit back there, it don't matter. You give all, you give $1 million, that's what God blessed you with. Give $2, which is like that widow, you gave the last $2, you still sitting up wherever you want to, right? So let us just think about that, because, you know, it's very important, you know, that there's some people that really give. I thank y'all for doing that as well. All right, and I think benediction, right? Yeah, that's it. Mm-hmm. All right, yeah, that's just the web, the store and stuff, website. So that's for people who have, make sure people on the internet. You can see we got a website as well. We got a store in case you want to buy some stuff. Get some of them flip flop things. We got a little kid, quarantine, walking through holiness, walking on holiness there. All right. Let us stand and do the benediction. All right. We thank you, God, for this time. We thank you for being able to laugh, to support one another, help us to understand more about you in our own personal lives, and also who we are as a community of people. Help us to reach those that surround us, that might be going through. Help us to be a light unto those who are lost, as you are a light unto us through your son Yahushua. He said, now we must be that light on the earth. We must be the salt on the earth to give it flavor. That you want us to just to raise up, you know, from being at the tail to now being at the head. That you're going to do it, not stuff that we're going to do ourselves. We thank you for your son, Yahushua HaMashiach, that came down and died for our sins, the gift that you gave, that died, that was resurrected, that ascended to sit on your right hand to petition for your people and for his return after he builds up a kingdom for us. We thank you. We don't only look back at the cross, but we look forward to his coming. So we try to live holy and righteous as much as we can, but we thank you for the Ruach HaKodesh to convict us and guide us, and we ask you to be with us as we depart from here in our daily life and our daily issues. We ask you to just give us mercy and favor, and we love you, and we ask you to protect all these people that's in your midst and those that's to come until we're able to meet again. We love you. We ask you to bless the food, the snacks that we're about to receive for nourishing our body. We thank you for being a provider, and then we ask you to multiply it if needed, but we know we don't have a lot, but we know that we're going to have more. We love you. We praise you. In Yahushua HaMashiach's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Love somebody. Speak to somebody you don't know. Hallelujah.